I'm missing. Oh, FISA.
Right.
He didn't leave the country, did he, for the break? Maybe he's, maybe he can't get back in.
I think I saw him.
That, you know, so. Okay, so let's get started. So this course is going to be handled very similarly, like the last course. So we can save a lot of time with a course introduction here, all right? You'll see this sheet's very, will look familiar to you, is the form of it. So we have the same problem as we had last quarter. When the laboratory is scheduled for some, I don't know, Saturday morning, no, I'm just joking, but it's no good, it's Friday afternoon or something like that. So do you guys have, does everybody in this room have, like we did last quarter, Thursday 3 to 5? Stilson? It's okay? Okay, so I have to check with Faisal and Savas, right?
I can go earlier. Okay, then it's done.
Yeah, usually, it, yeah. We try all the time and it never, hardly ever works. I don't know if it's ever working. Okay. Now, there is a little bit of a problem here. This is a course in electroacoustic transduction, basically, transducing between an acoustic wave and electrical signal. So it's important that you know some elementary electromagnetism. So how many of you have had that recently, like in a last year or two? I think the U.S., how many have not? Oh, well, yeah, Mark's laughing because you took it from, yeah, right. So that's no problem. That's not elementary, that's an intermediate level course. So even the USW students have, oh, good. That's usually not the case. Huh. Oh, that's great. I'm very happy because we have to deal a lot with, especially sonar. So, it's throughout transduction. Okay, well, that's great. We're going to use an NPS book. Bryan Wilson was a professor here. This is a small publishing house, and I think it's just like a one-man operation. I've talked to the guy. I got the solution from him when I first taught this course. He had Brian's handwritten solutions. He was a student here. And he might have taken Brian's course, I don't know. So if you guys, you can call him up and probably get a discount on, he loves NPS students. So I don't know how you got the book or if you're in the process of getting the book. But if you have a problem, call him up, that's why I put this in here. There are other books out there. This book is starting, it's kind of dated. But it's still good. It's got. Does anybody have the book yet? It's deceptively thin. Okay, it looks like oh, this is nice. Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of information here. Okay. There's a couple of other books one on the market, one in particular, but it's just too long. But if you're interested in those other books, drop by my office. Because I have to tell you, I'm not an expert in transduction, okay? I always go for commercial transducers. Only as a last resort will I make my own transducer, because it's difficult. Transduction is a very difficult subject, as you'll see. This is an advanced course. The course last quarter that's sort of considered at other universities to be kind of intermediate between undergraduate and graduate. So often what happens at a course at a normal university, there'll be some undergrads and some graduate students. That's the way it was at my previous university. But this this is a little different. This is tough, as you'll see. So we're going to do most of the book. We're going to omit chapter 9. That's done. Professor Kapolka will do that. sonar arrays and beam patterns. And it'll be about 5 to 6 pages of lecture notes. I don't think anybody will notice this, but this is actually, I think, a little less than last quarter. And the reason is, I had to go to font 14 for the last. Did you notice those lecture notes from last quarter were kind of, the font was kind of big? That's because I taught that as a distance learning course a couple of years ago. And the quality is so poor there. You cannot see Arial font 12 when it's projected on a screen in the over in Root Hall, in the VTC, the Video Teleconferencing Center over there. You guys are probably familiar with that. So I had to increase the font size on the lecture notes. That was painful. But I didn't teach this last time. An expert taught it 2 years ago. Okay? Somebody who lives and dies, makes his own transducers, his or her transducers. But the course didn't work too well. But anyway, I've taught this course. I should complete this. I have taught this course a number of times. I have learned a lot about transduction in the process of teaching this course. And have a lot of books that helped me get through this the first few times through, so you can always drop by my office and look at them if you want to. Okay. So this is going to be font 12, these lecture notes, which is fine for here in this room, but it didn't work over there. It's unbelievable. And that's just one of the reasons. That's really sort of the tip of the iceberg of why we're videoing in here and not using the VTC. Just the quality's too low. There's 7 take-home quizzes instead of 8. I'll still drop the lowest one. So tentatively we'll do the lab Thursday 3 to 5, and it's in. I'll show that we're not doing an experiment this week. It'll be next week. So this is just like I think last quarter. So is this. Okay. Anybody have any quick questions about the information sheet here? The syllabus. I don't know if I really need to do this, but it's such a. So this is a detailed syllabus, similar to last quarter. And I can't remember if I did this last quarter. So this is, Jay is a professional photographer. I think you guys all know this. And he specializes in figure skating. So this is winter quarter. Okay, so this is serious now. And so I put it in here. I might have put it in the last quarter's syllabus. I can't remember. But this is more serious now because it's winter. And so he's going to be here is a big chunk. He's going to, you know, he's on leave. He's out of town this whole week. So we got to work around that. The first lab will be next week. We definitely can't do it on Friday. We're not going to do it on Friday. He's not going to be here. There's some competition out there. Okay, so the labs are basically spaced 2 weeks, although I think because Jay's not, we have to change that a little bit. Oh, it's still 2 weeks there, yeah. And there's some holidays in here. Yeah, so you can see there's 3 weeks for this last experiment because it would be here. We could do it here. But Jay will be on leave. Okay. Now I put this in here so you guys would know. If you have to ask questions at the end, you'll know. You know. Okay. Any quick questions about the syllabus? Okay. So. Okay. So let's begin. Basically, what we're going to do today, I got to do this. So what do I do? So basically, what we're going to do today is look at an example of a transducer. Now, technically, it's not acoustic, but I've used it, and other acousticians have, because somebody who does physical acoustics, remember there's different types of acoustics, right? All kinds of acoustics. Oh, incidentally, a field of acoustics is transducers. It's a whole field. People specialize their careers just dealing with transducers. So these are people who often really don't care what's being measured. They just care about how it's done. It's so difficult and so important that people just specialize in the transducer. So that tells you something right there, right? It's not a simple subject. So we're going to look at an example of a transducer. It's technically not electroacoustic, but it's a good example. You can see everything, and you get the flavor of how we deal with transducers. Okay. This is probably called a sonar course, but we have to do some audio. What's called audio. Just as an introduction to sonar, you know, in air, acoustics in air. And so it serves as a good introduction to sonar. And also, we just have to do it because of the importance of it. You know, due to music and other, you know, audio, we just have to do it. So we're going to spend a few weeks sort of focusing on a transduction for in air, microphones and loudspeakers. And that's standard. So when I guess I didn't tell you guys last quarter. I know I didn't tell you today. I think I remember what happened in the last 10 minutes. But this is, when I first started to teach this, I tried to get out of it. I did everything I could, but it just wouldn't work, okay? So I had to accept the reality. I was going to teach a subject that I knew very little about. So I had a 5 months to prepare. I had some release time. Do you guys know what that is? So instead of like teaching a course, I prepared for this course. That's the way education ought to be. Unfortunately, nowadays, it doesn't work too well with a lot of financial problems, you know, considerations. So I had a lot of time to prepare for this. And the reason I'm mentioning this, I've forgotten. The reason I'm mentioning it is, I got these other books. I also got notes from people at other universities on this, experts in transduction, particularly Penn State. There's a big acoustics program there. And so it's just, it's very common. Are you available Thursday 3 to 5 for lab?
Yes.
Okay, good. Now, of course, at Penn State, they were, it wasn't dedicated to sonar. It wasn't, you know, that wasn't the high priority, I don't think. I can't remember. But I think it's a very natural thing to do some sound in air, okay, not to devote the entire time to sonar. It's very useful, and you can learn a lot.
May have your attention, please. Oh. The hazard has been cleared.
Now that's going to be repeated.
May have your attention, please.
Because you can't get it the first time.
May resume your normal duties.
How about again? Oh, no, it's twice.
May have your attention,
oh, yeah,
please. The hazard has been cleared. May resume your normal duties.
I disconnected the speaker in my office.
The hazard has been
when they renovated the building, put
may
all this stuff
your
in.
Like,
don't tell anybody.
May have your attention, please. The hazard has been cleared. You may resume your normal duties. May have your attention, please. The hazard has been cleared.
Do you believe it? You guys aren't surprised, right?
Duties.
Okay.
May have your attention, please.
Okay.
The hazard has been
cleared. I'll just try to lecture over that.
May resume your normal duties.
Because I don't know how long it's going to go on.
May have your attention, please.
I'd like to just to get something in.
You may resume your normal duties.
Right. Okay, so let's get started with this. We'll spend the rest of the lecture on this, and we'll complete it today. There will be some homework on this, just to, you know, because I think it's important for you to see this example. And there'll be a quiz. There's a quiz question on it. I can't remember what it is right now, but there's some quiz question on this. Okay, so what it is, it measures surface wave height. You know, it's water waves, like ocean waves. How do you measure the amplitude? Very appropriate for the Naval Postgraduate School. How do you accurately determine the amplitude? Okay, well, there are different ways of doing this. Now, some of you may know some of the ways. For example, you can optically scatter, you shine a laser light off a surface. And when a wave comes by, you have the photo detector here, you can actually do that. I tried it once, it didn't work real well for me, but this did for my when I was a graduate student. And what it is a resistive probe or sensor. I think I'm gonna change this to edit this to sensor. I think that's more common nowadays. You put two wires in a liquid like this, okay? And the key thing to see here is that if a wave comes by here, or if you just lift this or lower it, if you change the depth of the probe, what's going to happen to the resistance? Oh, all liquids have some conductivity. Maybe small, but they have conductivity. So if I change the depth of the probe, the resistance is going to change. So that's the idea. You know, that's the idea. Now they're all, so this is how transducers work, okay? People come up with a great idea, and then the trouble starts to happen. Right, and it's just one after another, and you'll see this right here. So that's the idea. And incidentally, why does which way does the resistance go? If the depth increases, if the height goes up here, does the resistance go up or go down? It goes down, right? You can think of this. You know, effectively, we have a bunch of parallel resistors here, and when the depth increases, we have more. We're adding more resistors in parallel, and that lowers the equivalent resistance. Resistance, you know, okay. So quantitatively, this needs to be edited. I realized 2 days ago. This is too strong of a statement. It's fairly accurate, but technically, it's just not so strong. How do we expect the resistance is going to behave here with depth of the probe? Well, what you'd expect is, if you double the depth here, it's like, you know, this is like a resistor across here. If I double it, it's like I'm adding another resistor in parallel. We expect the resistance to halve, okay? So we would expect this, okay? This is, I know from my experience, I have extensive experience with this particular transducer, okay? Which is not, I don't think you can buy these, this is homemade. Here it is, right here. We'll demonstrate it in a few minutes, or a little more than a few minutes. So you would expect this, okay? But, and it's fairly accurate, but it's not right. The reason it's not exactly right is there's a kind of end correction here. When you put a voltage across here and you get a current between here, right? If you're far away from this end right here, you're going to have essentially a two-dimensional flow of charge in a plane right here. You'll get this current, you know, electrons will be leaving one probe, going out and coming into the other one. And it'll be a two-dimensional. But down here, there's going to be an end effect. There'll be some current going like this. Furthermore, suppose you lift the wires here and you let y go to zero. You take the limit as y becomes smaller and smaller. And eventually, you get to y is equal to zero. So the ends of the probe are right at the surface of the liquid. Is the resistance going to be infinite? No. And why is that? Well, you still will be in contact with the liquid. And in fact, that contact is serious because there's going to be a meniscus. Right? What's going to happen is, in the limit, as you approach, now, here's the surface level right here. The surface will not look like this. It's going to look like that. There's going to be a meniscus there. So we can simply correct this. It took me a while to figure this out. But this is too strong of a statement. We should really write it like this. So the end correction is quantified by this parameter right here, this y naught. This fixes this problem here. Again, it turns out it's not real serious. This turns out to be very small compared to typical distances here. You have to be really close to see this. But this is more, you know, this is more accurate, a better way to proceed. Okay, now problems. We have problems here. One of them is if we hooked up a constant voltage here, okay, so imagine this is a short right here. Forget this, this is a short. As the wave comes by, how will the voltage across the probes change? I know, it was a long break. It's not going to change. That's the job of this, to keep the voltage constant. So we would have to measure current. The current will change. When the surface goes up, the resistance goes down, there'll be more current. Well, people do have measured current. It's sometimes important. I know one example. But usually you want to stay away from current. Usually you want to measure voltage. It's just much easier to deal with voltage. And there's a reason for that I'll mention later. One of the reasons I'll mention later. So that's a problem. Another problem is we want a linear transducer. If you have a wave, here's what linear means, a very important concept in transduction. You can't always get a linear transducer, but you usually want to do one because of it. It's so convenient. And here's what I mean by linear. If I've got a wave coming by here and I have a certain displacement amplitude, right, and I get a certain, we're going to eventually get, with this series resistance, we're going to be able to measure a voltage. You're going to see a certain voltage, okay? If I double the wave height, what do we want that voltage, how do we want the voltage to change? We want it to double. That's what we mean by linear. If what we're trying to detect, if the amplitude doubles, we want our transducer, the output of our transducer, to double. Then we can characterize the transducer with a simple sensitivity. So many millivolts per millimeter, right? So if I changed the height here, I want, by a millimeter, I want the voltage to change by a certain amount. If I change it by 2 millimeters, I want the change in voltage to double. That's a linear transducer. Now, if you don't quite get that, don't worry. It's throughout this course. The linear transduction is highly preferred. Sometimes you can't do it. There are examples. A hot wire microphone, for example, that just aren't linear. And sometimes you have no choice. You have to deal with it. Depends on your application. We'll talk about that more later on in the course. Okay, so regarding the first problem here, how do we measure voltage? Well, this is a standard trick. It's really simple. You put in a fixed series resistance here. This R sub S is a series resistor. So now this voltage is going to keep the voltage across this resistance and this resistance will be constant. If the surface wave is here, there'll be a voltage change across here. There will therefore have to be a voltage change across there. Let me look at the notes here. Yeah, so one of the reasons people like voltage is, typically when people deal with voltage, there's very little current. You know, when I put a voltage signal into the oscilloscope, there's a huge input impedance here. So there's very little current that's drawn. And in a system like this, you know, if we had significant current going through here, that could change the electrical nature of the liquid, right? This could be something chemical going on there, and it could change our sensitivity. So it's usually a good idea, you know, voltage. The idea behind voltage is you're not tampering with the system very much. And that idea of, you know, we don't want to go to a system. We want to observe something in a system. We don't want our act of measurement to change the system, right? That's fundamental to all of experimental science. It's the first thing you want to guard against. All right? And social scientists make this mistake all the time, right? Somebody's doing a survey or something, you know. Imagine asking people questions about something. Just your presence there talking about it, that's going to modify what they say to what they tell you, right? Okay, so that's a standard example of how the measurement process can affect what you're trying to measure. So they have to go to a lot of trouble, and you know, social scientists have to be very careful about that. And how careful they are, I have no idea, and I don't care. Okay? Okay, so, anyway. Now, it's tempting to say, well, let's look at the voltage. Let's measure the voltage across here. That does not lead to a linear transducer, you can show. And I think that's a homework problem. Did I? Whoa, where am I here? I think I wrote it down here. Oh, that's a quiz problem. Okay, that must be a quiz problem. Well, we'll find out, right? It turns out that you want to look at the voltage across here. And we're going to prove that, okay? We're not going to prove directly that you don't want to look at the voltage. You could, but it doesn't lead to a linear probe. And the proof of that is on the first quiz. Now, I want to make sure I want to understand something here. What does this mean, this voltmeter here? This is an ideal device that approximates, you know, actual voltage measurement boxes. Extremely little current, technically zero current. Approximately zero current is drawn here. Okay, so we can write down Ohm's law here. Ohm's law for the probe, the two-wire probe, is that the voltage across here, I'm going to call V this voltage across here. Ooh. This is just a symbol that means voltmeter. Okay, It's right. So let's let V be the voltage across here. Okay, by Ohm's law, that voltage has to be the current. There's a current going through here, then essentially no current here, times the resistance. All right? Now, we also can apply Ohm's law to the circuit as a whole. We know that the current through here is also going to be the current. There's just a single loop circuit here. So treating the circuit as a whole, we have the voltage is now V naught is equal to the same current here. It's going to be the same everywhere, times now the total resistance. So all we do is eliminate, you can do this in your head, we eliminate the current between here, and we solve for the voltage. And here it is. This is exact. Okay, now how do we get a linear probe? We want the voltage to vary linearly with the height, with Y. Well, you can see that this R is proportional to 1 over this, right? So, if we make the series resistance very small compared to the typical value here of this resistance, we can then neglect that. And I have 1 over R. 1 over R varies linearly with Y. We have a linear transducer. So you may wonder, well, wow, you have to, you know, how small do you have to make this? Hey, welcome to transduction, okay? These are decisions that you just have to make. And you just don't make them on pen and paper. You test them in the lab. And you find out. This is real stuff. And you find out by experimenting. And we're going to see a demonstration experiment today in this. Okay, so we need to choose the series resistance to be small. We can't take it to be very small. Okay, because if we take it to be very small, what's going to happen to the voltage across here? It's going to be very small. What happens when you're trying to measure a small voltage? Anybody have an idea? One word starts with N, noise. Okay, fundamental to transduction is noise. It's quantified by what's called the signal-to-noise ratio. We'll talk a little bit more about it, of course, later. So you can't take this too small. And again, you don't have to worry about this. You'll find out in the lab when you do stuff like this. You'll see a very noisy signal, and you'll say, okay, how do I get rid of the noise? Well, here, the first thing to try is maybe you've made this too small. You know? So make it bigger. You just have to make sure that it's much less than the typical resistance here. That turns out to be just not a problem, as you'll see. Okay. So everything's measuring voltage, which is good. We have a linear transducer, that's good. But there's another problem. Okay. And I'll never forget this. When I experimented when I was a graduate student. I tested this. I set it up, just this right here. In fact, I just put a voltage across here. And I let it sit for a day. I think it was a day, or it might have been overnight. So I came back and looked at it. One of the probe wires had dissolved. Literally, it had dissolved, which is pretty dramatic, right? And chemists have a word for this. It's called electrolysis. When you apply a DC voltage to some kind of liquid, like, you're dealing with electrolysis. There are chemical changes that are going to occur here. So we have, that's no good for us. With these chemical changes, it's going to change, drastically change the sensitivity. It's no good. And, you know, if we lose a probe wire, it's all over, right? So how do we get around this? Pretty obvious. We go AC. So we're going to put an AC signal, not DC. It's going to have to be AC. Now, AC can cause some chemical changes, and actually, towards the end of this course, we'll talk about that. People have turned just about everything, just about any physical phenomenon, they've turned it into a transducer. Once you get the mindset of the whole idea of transduction, I'm sorry, I didn't tell you, it's written in the notes. The basic definition of transduction is you're converting energy from one form to another form. Okay, that's sort of the basic idea. Now, in our case here, in the case of a receiver or a sensor or a probe or a receiver, there's essentially no energy. You know, when we measure the wave height, we're losing essentially zero energy in the wave. Okay, so this idea of converting energy from one form to another is it's kind of crude, I think. It's appropriate for drivers, very appropriate for drivers. But for receivers, it's not so appropriate. But technically, it is going on there. I missed that, sorry. So anyway, right. So with the AC, there's still probably some chemical reactions going on, but they're not permanent, because you're changing the voltage. So whatever happens when you go one way, you're going to undo it when you go the other way. So we can live with that. It's not going to permanently change the sensitivity. It's just going to be part of the sensitivity. Okay, so we need to go AC, and we want to apply an AC voltage across here that has a relatively high frequency, substantially higher, much higher than the typical frequency of a wave. Why do we want to do that? Well, you'll see. Okay. Okay, so. All right, so we remove the electrolysis problem, but now we've got another problem. We've got this high frequency signal here. So if you look at the voltage across the signal, when a wave goes by, when you look at the voltage, and you need to offset. I'm going to offset the voltage here. I'm going to subtract off the constant value, so it'll be referred to zero here. What we're going to see is something like this. All right, it's hard to draw this, but here's the surface height. The surface is doing this. This envelope here is proportional to what the surface height is doing. Measured from equilibrium, zero at equilibrium. We've put this, we have this carrier in here, right? This is you're probably familiar with this. This is often called a carrier wave. We've got to demodulate. We've got to get rid of that carrier. So there are ways of doing this. One way that's very convenient here is with what's called a lock-in amplifier. So I want to discuss that next. Okay, you probably haven't heard of a lock-in amplifier. Nowadays, most people just run to an FFT signal analyzer. Have you guys used that in the acoustics lab, an FFT analyzer, Stanford? Oh, yeah, I guess this is the course where you first use the analyzer. Oh, wow. Really? It's a kind of big box and does fast Fourier transform. You can see the spectrum. Okay, well, you're going to do that. It's coming back to me now. I think that's part of the first experiment. So next week you're going to be doing this. These are very common boxes everywhere. They're so convenient, right? But I've got to warn you, no piece of equipment is perfect. no transducer, every transducer has its limitation. And that's one of the reasons you're taking this course, understand the limitations of transducers. And it holds true with any experimental piece of equipment. There are cases, and I encountered one in the 90s, been a while now, where we tried, we wanted to use an FFT. I did everything I could to use an FFT. And it was taking too long to do the averaging. We were digging a signal out of noise. We had inherent noise in the system. I guess I need to tell you what we're doing. We had a sound signal in a pipe. And we also put high amplitude noise, acoustic noise in there. We were interested, it turns out that a sound wave in noise will attenuate due to the noise. It's a non-linear effect. The signal that you're putting in there interacts with the high amplitude noise. For linear waves, the waves just travel right through each other as if, you know, there's no coupling there. That's linear waves. The total response is the sum of the individual responses. There's no coupling between the waves. But when you have sufficiently high amplitude, you get all kinds of effects like shock waves. I think we talked about that last quarter. So another effect that you're going to get is it can actually cause a wave to the noise. The signal interacts with this high amplitude noise, and the effect is it removes energy from the signal. And no one had experimentally verified that carefully. Some Russians claim, a Russian theorist, God, I'm getting way too deeply involved in this. No one had done it accurately, okay? Some Russians had claimed they'd done it, and they showed this hand-drawn sketch of what happened. It was just a joke, okay? So we did a careful quantitative experiment, and we had to use a lock-in amp because we had all this noise inherently in the system. We can't get rid of it. That's what the experiment is about. So we had to dig this signal out of noise, and we used a lock-in amplifier. It was a case where an FFT analyzer essentially failed. You would have to wait too long to do the averaging there. So to get an idea of how a lock-in amplifier works, we don't have time to go through all the details here. I just want to get you sort of the basic idea. Here's what we got to do. We want to demodulate. We want to get rid of the carrier. So here's our signal. Our signal has this carrier on it, okay, with some phase constant here. We don't know what it is. It's got some carrier in it. This is what we're trying to detect. This is the slowly varying part. And you can actually imagine that to be a constant if you want to right now. A lot of times when people use a lock-in amplifier, they have a signal with a constant amplitude and they're trying to dig it out of, that's the common application. They want to dig the signal out of the noise. So F is just a constant there. Our case is a little bit more general. We have this slowly varying, you know, wave height. But the idea is the same. So how do we get rid of this? Well, the answer, here's the simple theoretical way to do it. A lock-in does this a little bit differently, but the rough idea is the same. You take your signal and you multiply it by the sinusoid at the carrier frequency. All right, so what happens? When I multiply my signal by this, this is our signal, and we want to get rid of this. Well, we use a trigonometric identity here. The cosine of alpha minus beta, you know, is the cosine of alpha times the cosine of beta. We encountered this last quarter, okay? To most people, that's a trigonometric identity, but to people who deal with waves, you know, oscillations, it's just part of waves, you know, this identity right here. Well, we'll talk. I shouldn't. We'll talk more about how we physically look at this. This is not in this form. It's really not that. Yeah, this is not that physical. Forget what I just said. So we use this identity here that you've all seen. You're familiar with. Okay, that's what I've done going from here to here, and we get two terms because we have these two terms here. Okay, now we're going to average over one cycle of the carrier. Over one cycle of the carrier, F has changed very little because we have a fast carrier relative to the signal, right? So over one cycle, this F is approximately constant. I can take it outside the integral, okay, as long as the carrier has a relatively high frequency compared to the signal that we're after. And now you've all seen this before. What's this? Anybody? 1/2. Remember, the cosine squared, you lift the cosine, the average there, by a trigonometric identity, the average is 1/2. What's the average of this? 0. It's equally likely to be positive or negative. You're going to get 0. And now we got this. Now, we're not quite done. We've got to get rid of this phase constant here. And that, and I'll edit this in, that's a homework problem. Okay? It turns out to be very easy. So the point is, with this multiplication and the averaging, we can demodulate. We can get at our F. Now, a lock-in, I'm going to edit this, add a little bit more substance to this. I say the actual operation of a lock is a little bit more complicated. Yeah, this is true. I'm going to leave that in there. But we can easily go one step further. What the lock-in does here is to get rid of this high frequency, the high frequency terms here, it does a low-pass filter. It has a very good low-pass filter. In fact, you can set it to be 24 dB per octave. I don't know if have you guys dealt with that before? That's a filter that falls off quickly, okay? Yeah, this lock-in right here. Here it is. I don't know if you can see it. It's down here. This is the best lock-in on the planet, Stanford Research System. It only costs $7,500. Well, last time I checked. It's a fully digital lock-in. And a digital lock-in is a little bit different than this, okay? But the rough idea is the same. So the lock-in. In the end, what the lock-in amplifier is doing, this is what you'll, when you look up lock-in, this is the first thing you'll see. What it effectively does is, you've got a signal at a certain frequency. That's called in lock-in language, it's called the reference frequency. They don't say carrier, they say reference frequency. What the lock-in amplifier is doing is, it's taking the amplitude at a certain frequency and down converting it to DC, and then filtering that to get rid of all the high frequency stuff. That's basically what a lock-in is doing. It's effectively a narrow bandpass filter. But, and you'll see people will write that, okay? But there's something you want to realize here. It's a narrow bandpass filter. You're only seeing the amplitude for a certain frequency. And that can be anything you want, the reference frequency. This effective bandpass filter is not attenuating the signal at all. So that's very important here, because usually with filtering, with standard kind of filtering, you're going to lose some of the amplitude of your signal. You don't want that here. You want an accurate measurement of the amplitude. Okay, unless you're a Russian and you... I don't know. So here's the real case. All right. Now, this works for water, but the system here, here's the probe wires. So let me take this, let me show you the system here. Oops, that's no good. I put this on here. This smell bothers some people, but I lived with this for years when I was a graduate student, but it doesn't bother me. But I put this just to kind of stop the smell. So this is ethyl alcohol. You can use water. Ethyl alcohol is good, however, because the alcohol has a high vapor pressure, as you know, and it will wet the walls and the wires here. If you just tried it with water, you can get an effect called pinning, where there's a kind of static friction here. Or even though the wave is coming by, it cannot, the contact point here cannot track the actual wave because of the static friction. That's called pinning when it comes to liquid. So you have to actually add something to the water. And I prefer, it depends, different people have different, you know, perspectives and feelings about this. I like to just deal with ethyl alcohol. Just removes the problem. So that's what you probably smell. I don't know. And what's been added to it? Anybody involved with air sea rescue? Oh, wow. No one? Has it anything to do with air sea?
It's a green dye packet that's
fluorescein. I think, I suspect it's also what they use every St. Patrick's Day when crazy people will color a pool green or a fountain green. They're probably using fluorescein. It's an extremely strong dye. It's great stuff. It allows us to clearly see the surface here. So, here's what I have hooked up here, okay? Oh, don't worry about this. It's not. I don't have it hooked up here. This is not really necessary. So here you can see it's very similar to our previous circuit. I just put in some values here. The typical resistance here is tens of kiloohms. It would be 100 or to 1,000 times greater if it were not for the fluorescein. So the fluorescein actually, we get two things out of the fluorescein here. It allows us to easily see this. It's beautiful, first of all. It has this kind of iridescence to it, right? It's great stuff. And oh, you only want to add a little bit. I got a container this big. Oh my God, 25 years ago. This is 2015. Yeah, I still am using that container. I should have brought it here. Yeah, it's a little tiny container. You just put a little, it's really strong. This is one of the reasons it's used in air-sea rescue. A little bit goes a long way, and that's what you want if you're in the ocean somewhere and you want somebody to pick you, get you out of there, right? Okay. So this helps here, okay? So we just have to, remember we have to make sure this is small. So 300 ohms is fine compared to that. That's a 0.5%. This resistance is the typical resistance here, it's 0.5%. That's fine. Now, there is, so here's the probe. Can you see the two wire, I don't know if you can see the two wires in there. Here's a typically, for transducers, here's a connection box. Okay, so the probe wires go here. We have an input. We got to drive it with that 60, with a high frequency. Oh, it's 5 kilohertz. Did I mention? I guess I haven't mentioned it. Oh, it's in there. Yeah, so we're going to drive it with 5 kilohertz. This is basically, this box is for just to connect the cables. The only thing inside here is the series resistance. That's all. You know, a lot of times people see this and they go, oh my God, I'll bet it's really complicated. There's all kinds of, I don't know if you can see this. It's just a resistor, okay? But you got to hook it up right, right? But it's just nice. It's just very convenient to do this. And then we make the connections here. Okay. So. I'm running out of time here, unfortunately. But you can calibrate this transducer by varying the depth with no waves, but just DC varying the depth and looking at the voltage that you get, the output of the lock-in. You can calibrate this. And look at this. So here's the calibration. Here's the voltage as a function of the height, the depth of the probes, essentially. Okay, and the zero is not all we're important. All that's important here are changes in voltage, changes in height, so we don't care about the zeros here is not significant. And look at that. This is a linear probe. It's a linear probe. That's actual data that we published. Okay, so let's do the demo here. I'm going to turn on the wave height maker. Oh, the waves are made by this wedge. See that acrylic wedge right there? It's connected to a loudspeaker, another transducer. Right? And this is 4 hertz. And here's the demodulated up. I'm triggering on the drive to the loudspeaker so that this doesn't float around. Okay? And that's the surface wave height. If I increase the amplitude, I'm driving this pretty hard, but you can see how it increases. Oh, what's starting to happen there?
It's still
loud. Oh, it's okay. If you drive too hard, it'll start to become nonlinear. Always, you're guaranteed this is going to happen. I can show you that. I think. I think those are transients that you see there. Looks like they're going away. Are they going away? Something's going on. You can hear it's knocking around. That's no longer a linear drive. In fact, you can feel that it's topping and bottoming out here. Our drives no longer. There can also be nonlinearity in the waves, but I don't think these are too small of amplitude for that to occur. Okay, so we increase the drive. You got, you know, this is, it's going to be a linear transducer. What about if I, what if I decrease the drive? Okay, you can see that the amplitude's less of the wave maker, I think, right? Well, the signal's less, right?
Well, that's no problem, is it? We can just turn up the gain here.
Okay, and now it's, you can see there's a transient time, right, for this to settle down. Because these waves, come, they're reflecting off here. By the time they get back there, they're at a low amplitude. It's mainly a traveling wave at that point. But, you know, there's going to be a transient time due to the reflection off here. What if I keep, here's an interesting question. What if I keep lowering the drive amplitude? We have to increase the gain on the scope. Well, it still looks good, right? What if I lower it to the point that you can't see it anymore? Can you guys see that wave height moving? Let me make sure it's moving. I'm going to look at light reflected off. A sensitive way is to look at light. I don't think it's moving. Let me turn this up just a little bit. Okay. Can you see the wave height maker moving? The wave maker moving? Well, the wave's there. See that? That's the same frequency, right? You can see the time, the period is about the same. It's wave, but what's happened? We're starting to see noise. It's ultimately every transducer. It's quantified by the signal to noise ratio. And, you know, so how do we. Oh, here's something else that's happening. Watch this. This is going to settle down, okay? Now, this could be acceptable to you. It could not. It all depends. You can do, there's certain things you can do. You can do some filtering here. You can go back. But I want to show you something interesting here. So it's settling down, right? Watch when I touch the oscilloscope. What happened there? There's some electrical thing with me touching. Do you see that? I'm moving the table. We're zoomed so far in here now that just a little tap of the table. Look at that. Okay, it's impressive. That's impressive. And there are ways of cleaning this up. One way is to, if you go back and look at that circuit diagram, you can add a preamplifier with some filtering in there. Okay, so anybody have any quick questions? All right.